Welcome back, everyone, to Open Line, talking about the opioid crisis in Tennessee. Where do we stand right now? What is being done, specifically through the courts, to address the crisis that we face in our state? We have on the phone Jessica. Let's go to Jessica. Hello.
Hi there. How's it going?
Great, great. What's on your mind?
My cousin was addicted to opioids. She had one of those unfortunate and then got addicted, and she has two young children. Her husband was trying to take the children away, and it was very traumatic for our entire family, and they live in Arkansas. And I just wanted to hear a little bit more about what the state of Tennessee is doing for mothers addicted to opioids.
Okay, good. Thank you. Thank you for the question, for sharing that. Judges face this all the time. What about our question there?
So I think there's a unique challenge for women, and particularly pregnant women, in getting access to treatment. Even for, you know, the evidence shows that getting access to medications for opioid use disorder improves outcomes. Even for women who, pregnant women who make it into treatment, only half get those medicines. The vast majority of people with opioid use disorder are not getting the treatment they need. The National Academy of Medicine, this is what Congress commissions to write scientific reports, came out with a report earlier this year that just says medications for opioid use disorder saves lives. And it highlights how people are just not getting them. And Tennessee women are just not getting them. It's not unique to Tennessee, but particularly in rural communities that have been disproportionately affected by the crisis, people can't get access to treatment, and particularly pregnant women can't get access to treatment. And the complexity that we're talking about here in terms of foster care placement, we've seen from 2001 to 2017, from some of our work, 10,000 more U.S. infants were in the foster care system, most because of the opioid crisis. A big increase. And in some states, like my home state of West Virginia, 4% of infants are in foster care. 4%.
Oh, my goodness.
Most, again, to the opioid crisis. So what are we doing, and what do we do? Well, first off, we are seeing some changes in terms of availability of medications, but we need more. We need more structural change to make sure that pregnant women can get into the treatment they need. We have a clinic at Vanderbilt for pregnant women with opioid use disorder, but women come from hours away for that clinic. Our state services, like our child welfare system, DCS, needs more resources. They just do. They need more caseworkers. They need more funding for that. So I do think this is one of the things I hope we start to see. Sometimes we do respond to this as, you know, we in piecemeal sometimes. We respond in terms of like medication, something like that. What we've seen when we actually began to turn the tide for the HIV crisis was Ryan White. It was structural change where we had funding, we had coordination that was long term. That's really what this is going to take. We have a long way to go to help families like that.
And what about, all right, she's saying this was a mother, she became addicted. I think at some point you were talking about pregnant women who are given, after a C-section, and sometimes even after a normal birth, given pain pills. Is that right? Or what did you say there?
Well, I mean, yes, that we have heard that from a number of people, and it is concerning. I don't know how widespread it is. I don't know what is being taught about prescribing practices to OBs, but, you know, that to me is extremely alarming. But back to the lack of services, there are several places in Tennessee, but there's so few when you think about the numbers for both pregnant women, and then not even pregnant women, but just women with children, mm-hmm. like the person who just called in, so that she and her children could go someplace and recover. I was involved with helping start Renewal House, which originally began as a home for moms that had crack cocaine addictions. And so now we've kind of come full circle. Now it is really becoming a place for placement of moms with an opioid or other type of drug addiction, where they can bring their children and recover together. Because the sad thing to me is that we are spending the money. If we are putting mom in jail, and we are putting kids in foster care, we are spending more money, but we are not fixing or healing the family.
That's a good point.
So I think we need to really think about how we're spending the money.
Nationwide, from some of our work, every year we spend $500 million just to taking care of babies with opioid withdrawal just during the hospitalization. And we could use those resources far more effectively than we do.
So you have a list there of treatment centers. It's not a very long list.
No,
it's not. How long are people in treatment? Like, how long does it take to to be treated?
Well, Renewal House, as I said, is probably, the average might be 18 months. It's over a year.
So that's a long time.
And so it's a long period of time. But the other thing that when you come out of there, you have had job training. You have either gotten a degree or you've gotten some kind of certification so that you can get a job. You have had parenting skills. Your children have the necessary supports that they need. You have family counseling. And so you are really hoping that the next step for these families is that they are in a recovered state and that they are going to be able to be productive citizens, tax-paying citizens, and that their children are going to be healthy and be successful in school settings.
It's worth talking about, too. Over the last year, we've seen a lot of change, and a lot of actually led by Senator Alexander, to the child welfare system. There's two bills that passed, the Support Act and the Families First Prevention Services Act, that basically help states deal with the opioid crisis in terms of foster care. It gives states flexibility to use some child welfare dollars for prevention. So how can we prevent that foster care removal upstream by providing people with services and treatment? How can we make sure, create plans of safe care so that we know when we send infants home that they have the resources, the plan in place to keep the infant safe, to try to connect the mom to services? We're just on the front end of these programs getting implemented, but they have the potential to really transform the way that the child welfare system works and the connection to treatment.
I mean, the programs sound great, and that's what we need. I think the argument that needs to be made is the financial argument. In Tennessee, we don't have a lot of money to throw around. Any bill that's put forth in the legislature has some sort of fiscal note attached to it, and there's just not a lot of money. But I'm encouraged and interested in the argument you put forth about the money we're spending on foster care, the money we're spending on incarceration. We could save money by doing some of these other things.
Exactly. Well, and the amount of money on the NAS babies. So if we go upstream, and Senator Alexander literally pushed forward these two bills, the Families First Act was actually how we started Renewal House. And so because now we are able to use money on prevention, but again, it will take our DCS, our child welfare agency, to kind of repurpose some of the money that they're able to pull down from the federal government.
One of the things we're not talking about right now is Medicaid expansion. Medicaid expansion would provide a lot. So first off, if we expand Medicaid, almost all of that is federal dollars. And even when we were talking about it during the Haslam administration, the hospitals were willing to pay the difference. That really would provide the resources that people need to get into treatment. Right now, pregnant women who have an opioid use disorder deliver their infant. Many of them lose health insurance coverage after 60 days. Mm-hmm. We know that increases the risk of death. So Medicaid expansion is one of those things that we could be discussing.
And Tennessee hasn't done it. Other states have.
Kentucky has.
Yeah.
Arkansas has. And it looks different in every state. There's a lot of flexibility in how it's implemented. But it would be, most of that money comes from the federal government. It would be good funding for the state, and it would help improve the lives of people in the state.
Let's go to Steve.
Hello.
Yes, Steve. Go right ahead, Steve.
Yes.
What's on your mind?
I just going through the process of getting a spot grant right now to get into the treatment for court and everything like that. And the process to do that is just long and extensive, and trying to get that done is a headache.
A spot grant.
Are you here in Davidson County?
I'm in Rutherford County.
Okay.
In Rutherford.
Have you been in drug court there?
No, ma'am.
Okay.
All right. Thank you. Do you have another question? Or I appreciate you bringing that up.
That's it.
Okay. All right. Tell us what a spot grant is.
Well,
do you know what a spot grant is?
Actually, or? I don't. We could Google it.
Well, that's okay.
But he hasn't been in.
He's seeking help.
Yes.
You know, that's the good news.
But it's too hard to get help.
He's frustrated.
It is easier to go get a prescription for pain medicine than it is to get help for addiction.
That's terrible.
That's not just Tennessee, that's everywhere. It just shouldn't be this hard. Most people in the United States who have substance use disorder can't get in for treatment. It's super hard.
Mm-hmm. All right, well, keep trying.
Absolutely. I really want to encourage anyone yes. out there who is looking or seeking help, if you can use any of these numbers that, again, we will have online for you, but 1-800-889-9789. Every single time that I speak, I will tell people, get your phone out and put this number in your phone, because you never know when someone may say, I need help and I need it now.
We can give you a number to the treatment locator too. There's a treatment locator where people can put in their address and find places around to get treatment. That also can be a resource.
But okay, good. And that's a good number. 1-800-889-9789. We'll take a break. We'll also put this number up at the very end of the show. We'll take a break. Be back right after this.